Hey guys, welcome back. In the previous video, we just have discussed about the number system. What is number system? Why we are going for number system? Then what are all the conversions of number system from one form to another form? Then also we have seen about the fractional conversions. So how the fractional values can be converted from one number system to another number system. And here in this class, we are going to discuss about algorithm. So before getting into this algorithm, first, we should know what is the step that is to be followed when we are solving a logical and numerical problems. So when we have a problem to solve, then we should follow some steps in order to solve that problem. So these are all the steps that is involved in solving a problem through computer. The first one is problem definition. So in problem definition, we should know, we should have the clear understanding of the problem, and we should define the problem statement. That is, what is a problem is for, and how the output should be there for that particular problem. So that thing should be defined here. So that is what the problem definition. And the next one is problem analysis. So in problem analysis, we are going to determine the resources that is needed for solving a problem, like what kind of variables are needed for the particular problem, and what kind of function and what that function should contain. Like these kind of resources should be determined, and that should be analyzed before going for writing a program or giving solution for a problem. So that is what the second step is. And third one is the algorithm development. So in algorithm development, we are just going to write step-by-step instructions. So which will say us how to solve a problem. That is what the algorithm development. And the next step is coding and implementation. So with the help of that algorithm that is developed in this third phase, so we are going to write a code, and then we are going to implement those code. So that is what your fourth phase, coding and implementation. And finally, testing and debugging. So whenever a code is written, and whenever we have completed the application, or whenever we have completed the program, then we should test that program to make sure that there is no error in the program. And the program is actually about to give the required output. So we need to test all these things. So that is the final phase, which we are having testing and debugging. So we are going to test the code that we have developed so that the code will produce the correct output, or the code will produce the required output. These are all the basic steps we need to follow when we are going for solving a problem. Now, we'll just see this third phase, algorithm. So that is what our today's discussion is about. So what is an algorithm, how an algorithm should be, and what are all the representations of algorithm? So those things we'll discuss now. Starting with what is an algorithm. So generally we say algorithm is a step-by-step instruction. So algorithm is a step-by-step instruction which is used to solve a problem. And here we have a definition for algorithm. So algorithm means it is a sequence of unambiguous instructions for solving a problem. So whenever we are writing algorithm, that algorithm should have some instructions, and how that instruction should be, it should be of unambiguous instruction, which means those instructions should not lead to any confusions for the programmer. So that is how the instruction should be written in the algorithm. Also, it should be of sequential order. So it should be in a sequential way. If we change the sequence, then we won't get the required output. So always we should write the algorithm in a sequential way. So it is a sequence of unambiguous instruction for solving a problem. And when we say algorithm, this algorithm is not only used in the programming languages for writing a program, but even in our day-to-day life, we are using the algorithm. So as I mentioned, it is a sequential process or it is a step by step process. So whenever we are doing something, whenever we are performing some task, or whenever we are doing some process, in that we will be following some of the rules, or we'll be following some of the steps to complete that particular task, right? So even that is also termed as an algorithm. For example, when you want to bake a cake, okay, so for that baking, we have certain things to follow. We have certain process to follow, right? For example, first we should take a pan, then we should prepare the cake mix, then we have to keep that in oven, then we have to switch on the oven, then we have to set the timing for that oven. Like, we have some set of procedures to be followed even for cooking a, even for baking a cake. Likewise, in day-to-day life, if in everywhere, you can see whenever we are doing some task, then we have certain procedures to be followed. So that is generally called as an algorithm. In the same way, in computer, when we are having a program, that is when we need to perform some task, so we have to follow some procedures, we have to follow some sequences. Okay, so that is what an algorithm here. And why we are going for this algorithm is in order to instruct a computer correctly. So first the user should have a clear understanding of the problem, right? So when the user have that clear understanding, then he should be able to develop a method, and that method is nothing but the sequential steps to solve it. That is what your algorithm is. So once the problem is well defined and once the method of solving it is developed, then we can instruct the computer to solve that problem, and that will become more easier when we are going in this way. Okay, so first we should know the problem well. The problem should be defined well. Then after that, we should write the algorithm for that problem. And after that, we can go for programming. And if we do like these, if we follow these steps when we are going for solving a problem, then it would be very easier task for solving that problem. So once a problem is defined, then the steps that is required to solve that problem should be stated clearly in the required order. So that is what your algorithm consists of. And coming to the characteristics of algorithm, so how an algorithm should be, right? So when if we take a problem, okay, there are number of ways to solve that problem. So in all that number of ways, in all those number of ways, we can write algorithm, which means for a problem, we can have number of algorithms. And with that number of algorithm, so we can go for a selective algorithm based on the efficiency of algorithm. Like we can say how faster the algorithm is going to be executed and how much space the algorithm will take to take, that is to be stored into a memory, right? So based on the based on these aspects, we can select the algorithm for a problem. And these are the characteristics for an algorithm. So the first one is it should be clear and unambiguous. As mentioned, whenever we are writing an algorithm, so that algorithm should give a clear meaning. That is, it should not confuse the programmer. When a programmer is writing a code or writing a program based on the algorithm, so it should not confuse the programmer. That is how the algorithm should be. And the next one is well-defined inputs. So whatever the inputs that is given to the algorithm, so the algorithm should contain at least zero or more than zero inputs, and that should be an well-defined inputs. The next one is the well-defined output. So based on the input given, it should be capable of producing the required output, that is well-defined output. And the next characteristics is the finiteness. Here, finiteness refers to the amount of time taken for executing that particular algorithm. So when we are executing an algorithm, so that algorithm should run in a finite amount of time. So it should not take infinite amount of time. So that is what the finiteness here. And then next one is the feasibility. So coming to feasibility, as I mentioned, when we are trying to solve a problem, so that problem have number of ways in, to solve that, right? So with that ways, some three or more ways may leads to the solution, actual solution. So like we have some possible ways to solve a problem. So that is what the feasibility here. So the algorithm should be feasible. That is, it should give a possibility for solving that particular problem. And the final characteristics is the language independent. So independent of languages. Here language means programming languages. So independent of programming languages, whatever the algorithm you are writing, that algorithm should be able to solve a problem. Then next one is the analysis of algorithm. So why we are going for this analysis is, right, like I mentioned earlier, when we have a problem, for a single problem, we have number of ways to solve that particular problem. So we have number of algorithms. We can have number of algorithms to solve a problem, particular problem. And when there are number of algorithms, so we should choose a particular algorithm which can be applied for that problem, right? So how we can choose that algorithm? So in order to choose that algorithm, so we have some parameters to be considered for choosing that algorithm. For that purpose only, we are going for this analysis. That is, here we are going to investigate the algorithm's efficiency. So based on the efficiency of the algorithm, that algorithm will be chosen for performing some particular task or for solving a problem. And here efficiency are classified into two types. One is time efficiency and the next one is space efficiency. So here time efficiency can also be known as time complexity, and space efficiency can also be said as space complexity. And coming to time efficiency, so this time efficiency means based on the amount of time an algorithm is taking to execute. So that is what the time efficiency here. Then coming to space efficiency, the amount of space, memory space required for a particular algorithm. So that is what the space efficiency here. Obviously, when we need an algorithm to be more efficient, then it should take only less amount of time to execute. Also, it should take only less space to get stored into a memory. So if these things are satisfied with an algorithm, then we can say that the algorithm is an efficient one. Then we can choose that algorithm for solving a problem. Next is the representations of algorithm. So coming to the representation, here we have three representations which can be used to represent the algorithm. First one is algorithm in simple English, then second one is flowchart, and finally pseudocode. Coming to algorithm in simple English, so here we are going to write the sequence of steps, that is sequence of instructions, step by step instructions for a program. And how these instructions are written means these are all written in a simple English manner. So that is why we are terming it as algorithm in simple English. So let us see one example. We need to perform sum of two numbers. That is, we need to add two numbers here. Okay. And for that problem, so we are going to write an algorithm. Okay. So how an algorithm should be? It should be in a step-by-step manner. Also, it should be in a sequential manner. We should not change the sequence here. And for solving sum of two numbers, so when we are writing an algorithm, it should always proceed with the start, right? So the step one is start. Then coming to second step, here we are going to declare variables. And what are the variables we are going to declare? Number one, number two, and sum. So here number one and number two, these two are the variables. That is, we are going to add these two variables. And what is this sum? Here this sum is used to perform addition of these two variables and to store the result of this variable. We are using sum here. Okay. And why we are going for declaration of these variables? Because whenever we are writing a program, okay, in that program, we'll be using variables like this. And the computer don't understand what are those variables. So what we need to do is we have to tell the computer that we are going to use these variables in our program. Okay, so we have to instruct the computer that we are going to use these variables in our program. And all these variables have some specific tasks to do, right? So we have to instruct the computer, and for that purpose we are going for declaring the variables. So whatever the variable we are using in a program, first we should declare that variable. Okay, so that is your second step. After declaration of variable, your third step is read values for number 1 and number 2. That is, we are going to add number 1 and number 2. We don't know the value for number 1 and number 2. So for that, first we should read the values for this number 1 and number 2. That is, we have to get the values for this number 1 and number 2. Then after finding the value, we can add these two numbers, right? So that is what reading values for number 1 and number 2. After reading the values, okay, after getting these values, now what we will do? We'll add this number 1 and number 2, right? So add number 1 and number 2. So after adding these two numbers, now we need to store the result, right? So we need to assign the result in another variable that is called sum. So here we are just adding the two numbers, that is number 1 and number 2. After adding these two numbers, we are assigning the result to the variable sum. This is our step 4. And coming to step 5, after storing the result to variable, so we need to display that result to a user. Okay, so if you don't display, we will not get any output that is to be displayed in an output screen. Simply, it will perform the operation and it will store the result somewhere in the memory in a computer. But if an user wants to see that result, okay, if the user want to take the output or if the user want to see the output, then it should be displayed to the user. So how we can display? Just by displaying the variable sum. So display sum. After displaying the result, we are just terminating the program. So it should end with stop. Always it should start with start and it should end with stop. And in between we have the sequence. So if you look at here, these steps are in sequential way. That is, first we have to declare variable. Then we need to get the values for this variable. After retrieving the values, that is after getting the values here, then we are performing the operation on those variables. So it is happening in a sequential way. If you change any sequence here, for example, this, if you change this declare variable as step 4 and if you are making the step 4 as step 2, then you won't get the proper result. Instead, you will get the error here. So it should be done in a sequential way. So this is how the algorithm, this is what the algorithm in simple English. This is our first representation of algorithm. And coming to the second representation of algorithm. So the second representation is flowchart here. And flowchart means it is a pictorial representation of an algorithm for solving a problem. So that is, in previous algorithmic representation, we just use some simple English languages, right, for describing the sequences. And whereas in flowchart, instead of writing writing the sequences in English way, here we are having the pictorial representation. That is, we are doing it in a diagrammatical way. Okay, so here we have pictorial representation of that algorithm for solving a problem. And for this pictorial representation, here we are using some symbols and these symbols are interconnected with each other. And each and every symbol has its own meaning and it has its own task to be performed. Like and why we are going for this flowchart is, this flowchart actually indicates the flow of control and information. That is, how the data is flowed from from one step to another step. So it indicates the flow of control here. And now we'll see some of the symbols that we can use in a flowchart. So these are all some of the symbols that we are using often in a flowchart. So this is the flow line, and this flow line is used in between these other symbols. Okay, so in order to indicate the flow of control, here we are using this flow line. And this symbol is the is called as a terminal symbol. That is, this symbol is used for start and stop. So in algorithm, how we are using that start and stop? So in the same way, in flowchart also, we have to use that start and stop with this terminal symbol. And the next symbol is the parallelogram. So here, this parallelogram symbol is used for input-output operations. So when we are going to get input, then at that time, we need to use this symbol. And whenever we are displaying the output, at that time also, we have to use only this symbol. And the next one is processing symbol. That is, this rectangle is used for processing. When we are doing some operations, when we are processing something, at that time we need to use this processing symbol. And here this diamond symbol is for decision making. Okay, so that is whether we should take this path or whether we should take another path, like we have to take some decision. So in that case, we will be using this diamond symbol, which is for decision making. And the next symbol is the connector. So this connector is used to connect our flowchart. So for example, when you are drawing a flowchart and that is your page is complete, and again you have some other the continuation of the flowchart, then you will be doing it in the next page or next paper. So at that time you have to use this connector symbol in order to connect that flowchart. Then this symbol is used for functions, like whenever we are writing functions, at the time we have to use this symbol. So these are some of the symbols available in flowchart. Now we'll see one example how a flowchart can be. Let us take the same example, that is performing sum of two numbers. Okay, so if you look at here, this is the start, that is the terminal symbol, and in that terminal symbol we are having start. Okay, after start, what we have to do, we need to read numbers. So we need to read numbers for number one and number two, and this is getting input. So that I have used parallelogram symbol here. So for input and output, we should use this parallelogram symbol. Here we are going to get input for number one and number two. That is reading input for number one and number two. So this parallelogram symbol is used. And the next one, after reading the input, we are performing operation on that number one and number two. That is, we are performing addition here. After doing addition, the result should be stored inside the variable sum. So here we are giving assignment statement also. So sum is equal to num1 plus num2. So these two values will be added and the result will be assigned to this variable sum. And this is what processing. So here you can see the symbol we have used is the processing symbol. That is a rectangle symbol, right? And the next one, after performing the addition and after storing the result in the variable sum, now we need to display this result, right? So that the user can able to see what is the output, right? So in order to display the result, here we are using display sum, because the result is stored inside the variable sum. So we need to display sum, and this is output statement, right? So this is the output statement. So here we are using the parallelogram symbol for displaying the output. For input and output, we are using parallelogram. For processing, we are using this rectangle, and these two are the terminal symbols. So here this is start and this is stop. At the end, after displaying the output, obviously we should terminate, right? So that we are using stop here, and these two are the terminal symbols. So whenever we are having a flowchart, so why we are going for this flowchart, what is the advantage of having this flowchart representation is, so it is very catchy and easy to understand than going for any writing statements or reading the statements. It is easy to capture things from a picture, right? So a pictorial representation is more catchy than writing an algorithm in a simple English or writing in some other way, right? That is what the major advantage of flowchart here. Then the last representation of an algorithm is the pseudocode. So here pseudocode means it is an informal language to develop algorithms. Okay, so it is neither an algorithm nor a program. That is, it is not an algorithm or a program, but it is an abstract form of program. For example, it consists of English like statements, and the statements perform some specific operations. This is defined for an algorithm, and here it does not use any graphical representation. That is, it won't have any pictorial representations. And here in pseudocode, the program is represented in terms of words and phrases. But here we are not following the programming syntax. Still, it is represented in terms of words and phrases. Now we'll see some example for the pseudocode. So we'll take the same example, sum of two numbers. Okay, performing sum of two numbers. How we can write a pseudocode? So as like algorithm and pseudo flowchart, we have used start and stop, right? And in pseudocode, we should start it with the word begin and we should end it with end. So these two phrases are used for start and stop, right? So whenever we are writing a pseudocode, instead of start, we should give begin. And for terminal, like for a stop, we have to give end. And in between, here you can see, first we should read the numbers. We should get the input for the numbers number 1 and number 2. So for getting input, we have to write it like input num1, input num2. So this is for reading the numbers or for getting the input for these two numbers. After getting the values or after getting the input, what we have to do? We have to perform addition of these two numbers and the result should be stored inside the variable sum. So that is what happening here. Sum is equal to num1 plus num2. After performing the operation, after storing the result in a variable, now we should display this sum. Okay, we should display this result to the user. So for that, here we have given the statement print sum. So here this print sum is used to display the result as an output, right? So this is how a pseudocode should be. It is an informal language. You can see here it is neither an algorithm nor a program and it is not using the same simple English words here, right? So here it is an informal language. It is using programming style constructs, but it is not written exactly in the programming languages. And this is all about the algorithm and the representation of algorithms.